Welcome back to Studio 10. Nice to see you this morning. Now, we're very excited about this. Our next guest gave the TV classic MASH the laughs and some real heart. Alan Alda is a multi-award-winning actor, writer and director. Let's take a look at his on-screen chemistry in MASH with Hawkeye Pierce and Hot Lips in action.
You low-life, disgusting son of a sewer pump!
Has anybody ever told you you have the voice of a songbird drowning in hot tar?
I suppose that piece of toast is for your time capsule.
Well, you certainly don't expect me to eat it.
I am trying to do something with meaning and heart, two things about which you know nothing.
Well, let me tell you something I do know. If you want to symbolize what we're doing here, bury an empty box.
Oh, go bury yourself!
May be best known for that role on MASH, but he is also a man of science and he's on a mission to get us connected and communicating. Alan joins us now from New York to tell us more. Good morning, Alan. It is great to talk
to you. Good morning.
Now, MASH...
You know, that show looks pretty good. I ought to watch it. That sounds really looked good.
It's actually, it's been 50 years since MASH premiered. That's unbelievable, isn't it?
Next year at this time, it'll be 50 years.
Have you got some celebrations planned?
You know, we gather and talk now mostly on the web because of the pandemic, and there's a lot of talk about a 50th year celebration on some television show. I don't know that somebody's trying to organize it, but that would be fun because it's been 50 years and it's amazing. You'd think in 50 years we would have aged, but we look just the same, don't we?
Well, yes, we actually got a chance to see you catching up on the internet on your incredible podcast, Clear and Vivid, because you had a mini MASH reunion. You spoke to Loretta Swit, who was, of course, Margaret Houlihan, Jamie Farr, who was Klinger, Gary Berghoff, who was Radar, and beautiful BJ Honeycutt, and you all caught up on your podcast. What was that like for you?
It was really fun. And I didn't realize how much fun it would be for the people listening. It was one of our highest rated podcasts. And we've had some really impressive people like Yo-Yo Ma and Helen Mirren and Paul McCartney. That was a wonderful one. Oh. And they wanted to see the gang from MASH. We've done it twice. So I think it would be kind of fun to do a 50th year celebration as well and get together on camera. We tend to kid each other a lot. That's how we would get ready on the set to get, you know, to be prepared for a scene. We wouldn't go over the lines as much as we'd make each other laugh by making fun of each other.
Well, in fact,
do you do that on your set?
You betcha. We occasionally forget to stop talking
when we
come back live. Yeah, yeah. Try not to tell us what to do. Actually, you revealed in one of those podcasts that you sometimes had your lines for the doctory sort of terminology in the wounds of the patient you were operating on, because it was important to you that you got that right.
Well, I had to get it right. But I didn't have it in an actual wound in a real patient. I just want to clear that up a little bit. Most of what we operated on were pieces of sponge rubber. So we had something to sew. You know, you put the needle in and it gives you a little resistance. That wasn't a human resistance, that was sponge.
Because it's hard to find extras
to do that. I often would put the sponge on top of the script so I could read the script. So I was an actual script doctor.
Wow. Alan, COVID has turned us into homebodies, and you've put together some great, great excuses for people who don't want to leave the house. Let's have a look at that now.
Come on, Alan, I'll break it down for him, okay?
Look, even if you're perfectly healthy, it's okay to want to stay at home. Maybe make some MASH-themed TikToks or LOL at some funny memes. Or have you heard about podcasts? I hear I have a pretty great one. You know, your friends will respect your choice. And even if they don't, Stephen Colbert and John Batiste have a few more excuses.
That was just the other night on Colbert. It was great, you know. But has the messaging around COVID-19 and vaccination and everything been communicated effectively, do you reckon?
No, I think the numbers show it hasn't been it's not being communicated, it's not being heard. And there are miscommunications, misinformation that is being communicated apparently better than the real truth in some cases. And people are taking medications intended for horses instead of for people, and they're putting themselves in danger. It's so interesting that we require vaccinations before kids can go to school in most places in this country. But where the public health is concerned in our country, they consider it an abridgment of their privacy or their rights to free choice, when they don't consider it an abbreviation of your right to free choice if you choose to drive on the wrong side of the road. Mm. If you drive on the side of the road you're supposed to drive on, that's mandated, you save your life and the life of other people. And it's the same thing with the vaccine. Mm. So if they're willing to do one, I don't quite get why they're not willing to do the other. I think we have to make the message a little clearer. Those of us who take the vaccine are safe, and those who don't aren't.
Mm, so true.
So well said. Alan, it's not only communication that is your passion, science as well is a big passion of yours. And Australian nurse Sister Elizabeth Kenny, she had a major impact on your life as a child. You were diagnosed with polio. Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, I got polio when I was 7 years old, which was just about 2 years after Sister Kenny came to the States to lecture. She was finally allowed to lecture. You know, you probably know, since she's such an Australian hero, you probably know that she was rejected by all the doctors that she tried to share her treatment with. They said, no, no nurse is going to tell us how to do medicine. And it took a long time for them to accept her, because she had found a way that worked to relieve the symptoms. And she trained people in the States shortly before I got infected. And my impression is it saved me. I was affected all over my body by it, except for one arm. And the treatments were effective, but very painful. It's almost scalding hot blankets wrapped around every muscle. Mm. Every 2 hours, I think, all day long.
Wow.
And a double dose at night, and painful massaging. I don't like to be massaged now because I still have not good memories of it, but it saved me. I'm agile. I do those handstands when I get excited, the cartwheels.
Yes, you did one at the Emmy Awards.
Yeah, I was so excited to win an Emmy for writing that on the way to the stage to get the Emmy, I did a cartwheel in the aisle. And I did another one when I turned 80. I thought, I'm out on a beach. I'll see if I can still do it.
And you did?
That's amazing.
It looks a little bit like an elephant tripping. I did turn over.
Oh. That is legendary. Hey, you mentioned a bit earlier that you've had some big names on the podcast. You did a legendary one with Paul McCartney where he even played the piano or noodled on it, as he called it. Was that fun for you to talk to such a music legend?
It was wonderful. And I thought it wasn't going to go well at first because the people in the studio where we recorded were so excited to have him come in. They put two guitars in the same room with us and a piano and put spotlights on the instruments, hoping he'd pick one up. And I thought, I said to them just before he came in, I said, you can't do that. That's rude. You can't expect him to play. And then he walked in and he saw the instruments and he didn't look happy. And I thought, oh, there goes the whole interview. But the whole point of the interview is to have a freewheeling conversation and to get close to each other. And we started kidding around, and I could see he trusted me a little bit more. And finally, I said, I'm really curious how you write a song. How does the melody come to you? And he says, well, I just do some chords. He had a funny name for the chords. I can't remember what he called them. But it's like noodling around. And then I saw he had gotten over the dismay of seeing the instruments. He said to me, there's a piano over there. You want me to show you what I do?
Yes.
And he started to write a song for me right on the podcast. And I was thrilled.
Oh, that is something to tick off the list. That is for sure. Alan Alda, you are a rare breed of celebrity that has enjoyed enduring popularity. The press here in Australia can't get enough of you as well. Do you remember being mobbed by Aussie journalists when you were here a couple of years back?
I remember we flew in from, we went to Honolulu first, and then we went to Auckland, and then finally we arrived at Sydney, and I was exhausted, and they had questions for me and for my wife Arlene. And the next day when the papers came out, all the things they wrote about was her, which made me really happy.
But you got mobbed by journos at the National Press Club. That never happens. Those journos make a point of trying to never look impressed by anyone.
Yeah, too cool for school.
And they all wanted the selfies. It was quite incredible.
Well, it's nice to be liked. It's better than the other way.
The nice guy of Hollywood, you're often referred to as, and I love that you also credit your beautiful wife, Arlene, for helping make you a better man as well. I read it's so beautiful, Alan Alda. We love you.
She helped make me a person. I owe her everything.
Oh, we love you even more now.
Oh, I hope so.
You can listen to Alan's podcasts, and there are a huge number of them, and they are fantastic. There's even 6 Degrees with Kevin Bacon up now. It's called Clear and Vivid. You can get it wherever you get your podcasts on your favourite streaming platform. Alan Alda, it's been such a delight to chat to you.
Thank you. I really enjoyed the time we spent. Thanks so much. Good morning.